give him glory. We come to lift our hands and give him praise. Give him glory. Give him glory. We come to lift our hands and give him praise. All right, let's do more. Feet this time, come on. We come to do our dance and magnify him. Come on, somebody. We come to do our dance and give him praise. Come on, somebody. We come to do our dance and magnify him. We come to do our dance and give him praise. Give him glory.
Give him glory. Give him glory. We come to do our dance and give him praise.
Give him glory. Give him glory. Come on, church. We come to lift our hands and give him praise. Anybody feel like praising? We come to lift our hands and give him glory. We come to lift our hands and give him praise. Give him glory. Give him glory. Give him glory. We come to lift our hands and give him praise. Give him glory. We come to clap our hands and give him praise. Everybody sing it. We come to clap our hands and send them to God. We come to clap our hands and give him praise. Give him glory. Give him glory. We come to clap our hands and give him praise. Give him glory. We come to lift our hands. We come to clap our hands. We come to dance our feet. We come to lift our hands. We come to clap our hands. We come to lift our hands. We come to lift our hands. We come to clap our hands. We come to do our hands and give him praise.
Good morning, good morning, good morning. I'm so glad everybody is so happy this morning. Well, good morning again to everyone. My name is Diane, and I'm here to acknowledge those that are visiting with us today. We have a very special, special person. Miss Christine. And her family. We are so happy to see you. Who she was, and then after a while, after I finished running my mouth, I said, "Oh my God, Christine! We are so happy to see you. Christine used to be right there,
yes, right
there. In the choir loft every Sunday. Every Sunday. And we're just so happy that you've taken the time out to come with us today.
Amen.
We have some more visitors with us today. I'm looking at you. Hi.
I'm Henry Carmen's daughter, Pat.
Okay.
This is his great granddaughter, Jana.
Oh, well, welcome. Welcome. Are there any more guests this morning? Yes, sir.
I'm James Stafford. I live in Arlington, Virginia. And I've been involved with the Poor People's Campaign. I've heard of that. Glad to be here.
All right. Well, glad to have you. Okay, and this couple here.
Good morning.
Good morning.
We bring you greetings from Shallow Baptist Church.
All right. Oh,
all right.
Sir?
I am Bishop Brandon Gerald. I'm from Bellsville, Maryland.
Okay. Amen. Welcome. See so many of you out today. The doors of Plymouth are always open to anyone that wants to come and worship with us. And if you have any special needs or anything special you would like to do, just come on up and speak to us after church service. Reverend is real good about that. About welcoming people, and if you talk to him too long, he will find something for you to do. Okay, anyway, so that's it. No more, because I'm famous for forgetting and not getting it quite right. And we have a wonderful choir here, and I see some old faces here. And I should let Pat know that the other day I was talking with Angie and Karen, and they were talking about you, and when they were young, and then I had to stop the conversation because I was beginning to feel so terribly old. Because my daughter's birthday is tomorrow, and I think she'll be 49. Anyway, okay, I had said 50 to her. She said, "Oh, no, Mom, not 50. I'm like, "Okay, then you're 49. Anyway, we're happy to have everyone here with us today. There's a lot going on. It doesn't seem like it, but there's a lot going on in our little church. One thing, this week, I said I was talking with Angie and Karen. Angie and Karen grew up here in Plymouth Church, and Karen is the daughter of Dolores and Wally Tosin. And we lost Dolores on Thursday, I believe it was. Was it Thursday? Yeah. Because the night before, they had called me. And all I heard was Dolores saying, "Diane, Diane, Diane." I said, "I did not do it." But it was good to hear her voice. And then, of course, I got the call the next morning that she had passed. So I ask that you all keep her family in your prayers. So I have something special that I wanted to read today. it's about a friend. You know, you have folks that you don't see them, may not see them for a few months, but you know that they are there in your heart. And that's what I want to read about. A friend is one of life's most beautiful gifts. A friend is a person you can trust who won't turn away from you. A friend will be there when you really need someone and will come to you when they need help. A friend will listen to you even when they don't understand or agree with your feelings. A friend will never try to change you, but appreciates you for who you are. A friend doesn't expect too much or give too little. A friend is someone you can share dreams, hopes, and feelings with. A friend is a person you can think of and suddenly smile. A friend doesn't have to be told that they are special because you both feel that way. A friend will accept your attitudes, ideas, and emotions, even when their own aren't different, and will hold your hand when you're scared. A friend will be honest with you, even when it might hurt, and will forgive you for the mistakes you make. A friend can never disappoint you and will support you and share in your glory. A friend shares responsibility when you have doubts. A friend always remembers the little things you've done, the times you've shared, and the talks you've had. A friend will bend over backwards to help you pick up the pieces when your world falls apart. A friend is one of life's most beautiful gifts. And this reminds me of Dolores and her husband. When the children were small, and every year when they would go on vacation, they would always take Angie with them. It didn't matter because they knew that things were difficult for me because my husband had passed and I had two small children that I was raising alone. And they always saw to it that they were part of, or if they wanted to go somewhere, we would switch up on who would drive them. So I love them both very, very dearly. I pray that you all have a wonderful week. Amen.
Tomorrow is Miss Morgan's 91st birthday, so we want to sing happy birthday to her, if that's okay.
Okay.
Please.
Oh, we had something else to do? 91st birthday? Oh, my goodness. Miss Christine, can you stand, please? They would like to sing happy birthday to you. But we can sing that next time. All right.
Amen. I'm reading to you from the book of James, chapter 3, verse 18. It says, "Peacemakers who sow in peace reap a harvest of righteousness." It is so nice to be here this morning with peacemakers out seeking a harvest of righteousness. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. It rained all day yesterday, right? It rained all day yesterday. A lot of us had to cancel plans. I found reasons to cancel plans. I ain't going to the grocery store doing laundry, nothing. It's too rainy. And then this morning I came out and the day was perfect. And that is how life is, right? You know, it rains and then it clears space for this perfect time. It's so nice to be here and worship with you on this perfect day. This is our time when we follow the tradition of getting out and shaking hands and hugging people and greeting one another in the name of the Lord. And so we're going to do that. And we do it with a greeting that comes straight from the heart. That greeting is, "The peace of Christ be with you.
And also with you."
Amen. Let's greet one another in the name of God. Amen.
I'm not putting this in the room.
my brother, Ernest Hargrove, is still out on vacation, but Earl Hargrove is here.
Yeah.
And celebrating your 70th birthday. Morgan, and somebody said, you know, that they were used to seeing her in the choir loft. But I want to express that she was in the choir loft also at 17th and P,
wow,
the church down there. So she had been in the choir, right, historically, right? So not just the existence here for North Capitol and Reed Grove, but her engagement in the choir, that goes back. And in fact, it was Madeline Johnson that sort of kept talking about how y'all sang, I think, in the youth choir. Right? The youth choir at 17th and P Street. So you need to give God some praise. And the day after service, you'll see that there's going to be a viewing of the movie Martin Luther King in Palestine. It's part of social action and sponsoring that. And that is out in the law hall, and I think there's going to be some food that will be served down there as well. And so please join and support that program. Today at 5, Brother Maceo Kemp and Sister Lucy Murphy will be drawing together in Lifting Up Jazz and Justice here in the sanctuary. So come and be a part of that. You're going to be blessed in that music program that's going to go on Sundays. And so we give thanks to God for that. Next week, at our 10 o'clock service, we have Bobby Felder and friends that is going to bless us musically at our 10 a.m. service next Sunday. And I also want to give thanks to God for the prayer seminar that got started last Thursday night at 6:30. And Dr. Carol Clark has been leading that, and it's continuing this Thursday, 6:30, in the chapel. Is that where we'll be? Or here?
Last week was here, it was hot in the chapel.
We'll probably be here again, but we're still hot. Amen. And so we'll join in our prayer seminar. And I want to remind you also of our prayer conference call on Wednesdays at 6 a.m. Prayer conference call, Wednesdays at 6 a.m. To 6:30. Lift all of those up in your thoughts and prayers. As you heard, Sister Dolores Colson has passed into God's glory. And we're planning right now on having service for her at Riderwood at next Saturday. So lift all that up in thoughts and prayers. I also want to draw your attention to a number of things that you can come and be a part of that is going on. One is we will have our Poor People's Campaign meeting next Wednesday, the 25th, from 6:30 to 8:30 at the Lamont Green Library. If you want to be a part of that, come by and be a part of the Poor People's Campaign as we continue to sort of organize and do the work that we're called to do. Also, there's going to be, not this Sunday, but next Sunday, a mass meeting that will take place at Ambassador Baptist Church at 1412 Minnesota Avenue South East, and that will be at 6. This on 26th of July, I will speak at the Jerusalem Fund, which is located across from the Watergate Hotel on Virginia Avenue, on similarities of racism at home and in Israel Palestine. And then we're building up towards an action on July 30th, and that action is at 6 p.m., and that's the challenge for the D.C. Central Cell Block to either clean it up or close it down. That was a cell block that held 9 of us for praying in front of the Supreme Court, and that God allowed us to see the conditions there and to recognize that thousands of sisters and brothers go through those inhumane conditions every single year. So we did have a meeting with the Director of Corrections, who gave us a good political kind of discussion that the mayor is concerned, the mayor is working on the budget, not sure what the budget will lead to. And so we said to him, that's your problem. If you were smart, you would use our outside pressure to get done on the inside what you need to get done if you're concerned about this. So join us in that action as we stand out with different groups and different entities to come together in demanding that the central cell block be clean or closed. Mm-hmm. There's no way in the world to treat human beings.
Yes.
So lift that up in your thoughts and prayers. It's now that time that we prepare to bring our tithes, our gifts, our offering into God's house. The Lord has been good to us and is good to us still. I'm going to ask if our chairperson, Brother Mark Brown, also Brother Alan Johnson, and Mark Brown, can come forth and share some words with the congregation. Brother Brown asked what I wanted to share, so whatever he feels like sharing.
Well, thank you, Reverend Hagler. Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
Many of you know I'm not lost for words, so I can always come up with something to say. And certainly, today, Sunday, is always a special day, but it's important that, as you all see the activity going on outside, the construction, we are hopefully and prayerfully getting closer to the finish line. It has taken a lot of prayer, a lot of hard work, and a lot of stick-to-itiveness to get us to where we are today. So I want to encourage all of you to continue to do your part spiritually, prayerfully, and financially to help us achieve our goal of the elevator. It has been worded, I understand. So things are coming together. We just need to continue to move forward. And I know we ask, Wilmington, Slaughter always asks, and Alan, and everybody here, we always ask if you can do a little bit more. And so I'm asking you today to do a little bit more for Plymouth. As we stand on this corner, we're not going anywhere. And we want to be a beacon on this corner for many, many years to come. I was just thinking, and I'll end with this morning, I was listening to HUR, and the gentleman was giving all the announcements of all the activities of all these other churches around the Washington metropolitan area. And I want to be able to, Wilmington and Alan, write that note to that gentleman when we have our ribbon cutting, and say, Plymouth is having their official ribbon cutting ceremony on such and such date at this time. So we'll let everybody in the area know that we've done our work, the church is now put back together, and we can now start on the journey of full recovery and back into full operational mode. So continue to pray for the church, the folks who participated in the construction, that we can get to the finish line. The contractor's talking the end of August, so we have our fingers crossed, and hopefully we'll get there. So continue to do your part and help us reach our goal. Thank you.
See, I do that from Mark Brown, who did a good job. and I want to thank God for not only this board of trustees, but also the previous board of trustees and the previous board of trustees and the previous board of trustees that have been absolutely faithful. And one of the things that we're discovering is that a lot of entities are being forced out of the city because of the rising price of being able to remain in the city.
Yeah.
So we're being approached by ministries and groups that can no longer afford to remain in the city. Asking us if they could share space. And see, that's God unfolding a whole other agenda for us.
Yeah.
And that we need to be open to the urging of what God is saying in the midst of it all. And we give thanks that we're able to stand on this corner, because you don't necessarily know how many congregations have been forced out of D.C. because of the rising price of being able to remain in D.C. And so we made a commitment to stay on this corner. We made a commitment to be a beacon of historical hope on this corner. And what is that worth? That's worth everything. So please be faithful and generous in your giving. Let us pray together. Oh Lord, we just thank you for your mercies and your wonder. We thank you for your challenges, because in challenges, Lord, we meet victory. Lord, we're able to come through only because you guide us through and lead us through and you carry us. Give us the strength when we need it, and give us the clarity as we need it. In all these things we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen.
No matter how you try, and just
for any of the young folks or those who are young at heart to come and take a seat right here on this front row, because we have been introducing our own little puppet ministry. Amen. Minister Robinson has been heading that. She wants to see what's behind.
Amen. A wonderful assistant. Thank you, thank you. She wants to see what's there. We just thank you. We thank you for these wonderful children, and may they be blessed and continue to be inquiring of all of the things that you will show them and reveal to them. We give thanks for each one. All these things we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen.
Thank you.
today from the Gospel of Mark, chapter 6, verses 30 to 34, and then verses 53 to 56. And if you're using the Pew Bible, you can find it again on page 873 of the Pew Bible. The apostles returned to Jesus and told him all that they had done and taught. And he said to them, "Come away by yourselves to a lonely place and rest a while. For many were coming and going, and they had no leisure even to eat. And then they went away in the boat to a lonely place by themselves. Now many saw them going and knew them, and they ran there on foot from all the towns and got there ahead of them. And as he went ashore, he saw a great throng, and he had compassion on them because they were like sheep without shepherd. And he began to teach them many things." And then skipping through verse 53 to verse 56, "And when they had crossed over, they came to land at Gennesaret and moored to the shore. And when they got out of the boat, immediately the people recognized them. I ran about the whole neighborhood and began to bring sick people on their pallets to any place where they had heard he was. And wherever he came, in villages, cities, or country, they laid the sick in the marketplaces and brought him and besought him that they might touch even the fringe of his garment. And as many as touched it were made well." May God have a blessing for the reading of those words. Amen.
Amen.
King, come help us.
Good morning, Plymouth.
Good morning.
It's one of the old hymns of the church, and I grew up in the southern part of Virginia. We would get to church sometime before the minister and his wife, who was our pianist, and we had back then what was called a prayer service right before the worship. I could hear the voice of my grandmother, and she would stand sometimes and sing this song. It's a prayer, really. If you know the song, please join in, for this is worship. Please join in worship, right?
Yes.
The last thing I want to do is be an entertainer. No wonder church don't pay that much. Just kidding. But I love worship, amen?
Yes.
Amen. And so, please. Lord, keep me day by day in a pure and perfect way. I want to live. I want to live, Lord, in a building not made by man's hands. That's right, y'all. Come on. Lord, keep my body strong so that I can do no harm. Oh, I want to live. I want to live, Lord, in a building not made by man's hands. You know what, y'all? I'm just a stranger here, traveling through this barren land. One thing I know, somewhere, Lord, yeah, there's a building not made by man's hands. Come, everybody know. Lord, keep me day by day. Lord, keep me day by day in a pure and perfect way. I want to live, Lord. I want to live, Lord, in a building not made. Now y'all gonna get this. Come on. We're gonna do this one more time. Lord, keep me day by day. Lord, keep me day by day. In a pure and perfect way. I want to live. I want to live. I want to live, Lord. I want to live, Lord, in a building. Can I just do that one more time? How many of you want to live in a building not made by man's hand? Lord, keep me. Lord, keep me day by day. In a pure and perfect way.
In a pure and perfect way.
But I want to live.
I want to live.
I want to live. I want to live. Lord, in a building not made by.
Amen. I want to thank Reverend King for his blessing of us. If you would join with me in a moment of prayer, Lord, we come to you and we just give you thanks this day for this word, this text, this scripture that is opened to us and for us. And we ask, oh Lord, that you give us not only the ability to read it, but to be able to perceive and discern what it might be saying to us in this time in which we live, these moments in which we stand. For one thing is always true, Lord, and that is that you are the potter and we are the clay. So mold and shape us as you would have us to be until we are perfectly fitted for your kingdom and able to call ourselves disciples of Jesus the Christ. Now, as we come to this teaching moment, Lord, you hone it, you shape it, you develop it, you send it forth as you see fit. Allow it all to be acceptable and pleasing in your sight, our Lord and our Redeemer. Amen. I want to speak on just a little bit on the subject, many came looking. Many came looking. Now, Mark, which is the oldest of the Gospels, right? It's the first Gospel that is written. The others follow suit. Y'all heard me say that before. I'm just trying to get you to understand the sort of the chronology of the development of the text. Mark is written first. And Mark constructs the telling of the story in the ways that he does, because he does not simply want you to understand what Jesus was doing and the impact he was making in the lives of people, but the writer of Mark wants you to feel the intensity, the passion, and the wild enthusiasm that was swirling around Jesus and his group of followers. He wants you to feel that if he can change radically the lives and conditions of people at that time, then maybe he can also change your lives and the status of our conditions right now. The people wouldn't leave Jesus and his disciples alone, and even when they went to be by themselves, to retreat and to re-energize, the people watched where they were going and followed them there as well. When he and the disciples got to where they were going, the crowds were already there. Jesus stepped out of the boat, and the people were there waiting, expecting, and hoping. And then I hear these words very loud and clear in the text. It says, "And Jesus saw them, and Jesus was moved with compassion." Why? Because they seemed to be sheep without a shepherd. Now I hear from the text that Jesus saw something in people's faces and felt something in their desperation. He saw something in the people that spoke to his heart and communicated to the core of his compassion that there was something that they needed and that Jesus was able to give. Jesus looked at them and was moved. And so the movement of his compassion that led him to teach just opened the floodgates to people in the towns and the villages to bring their needs because Jesus saw something in them and they saw something in Jesus. They brought people to Jesus, and Jesus was moved with compassion, as it says, because they were like sheep without a shepherd. Now, sheep and shepherds are a metaphor for a leader and for people. It is important that people follow someone who cares. That's what's implied in the text. Someone who operates with honesty and integrity. We should know that well. There are all kinds of shepherds. Even Jesus in the Gospel of Mark makes reference to shepherds, and shepherds who are not really shepherds but hired hands. There are shepherds, for example, who have no investment in the people and could care less whether they rise or whether they fall. The hired hand, Jesus says, runs away in times of peril. It says in John chapter 10, verse 11, the hired hand who is not the shepherd and does not own the sheep sees the wolf coming and leaves the sheep and runs away. And the wolf snatches them and scatters them. The hired hand runs away because a hired hand does not care for the sheep. Now, there is little or no connection in this regard between the shepherd and the sheep. The hired hand is concerned maybe with a paycheck or maybe with their status and not necessarily the protection or the security of the flock. There are also so-called shepherds who use the people for their own ends and for their own aggrandizement. Yeah. There are people who pretend to be shepherds and have used the sheep for their own advancement and enrichment by even slanting the teachings of the gospel to some kind of free market capitalism. This is prosperity theology and the prosperity gospels that dare to pervert the gospel into a state of blessings reflected by the accumulation of things. But we forget that Jesus speaks about the widow's mite in Mark chapter 12, verse 42, where it says, a poor widow came and put in 2 copper coins, which are worth a penny, and then he called his disciples and said to them, truly I tell you, this poor widow has put in more than all of those who are contributing to the treasury. For all of them have contributed out of their abundance, but out of her poverty she has put in everything she had, all she had to live on. Now, in other words, what Jesus was pointing out was that she placed her trust in God, yes, and not in the possessions she had. The others, Jesus defines, gave out of their abundance, but this woman gave from the nothing that she had. Oh, yeah. Jesus remarks that she gave more than all of the rest. Yeah. Or the teaching that Jesus teaches in Matthew chapter 6, verse 24. No one can serve 2 masters. For a slave will either hate the one and love the other or be devoted to the one and despise the other. You cannot serve God and mammon or God and wealth. And you see, what I'm getting at here is that there will be teachers and leaders who will teach all kinds of things looking to prey upon the emotions and the desperations of people. But Jesus looked at the people and was moved with compassion because the people were like sheep without a shepherd. Now, this is a dangerous moment for the sheep when the sheep is deprived of a shepherd. That's a moment of vulnerability. That's a moment when people are looking for something to try to give them direction. That's a moment in which people can be preyed upon, P-R-E-Y-E-D, upon, and can be manipulated and used. I want to take us down a little roadway here. Help us get to understand what I'm talking about. When Martin Luther King Jr. was killed, there was desperation, and it broke out in rebellions all across the country. Even when Malcolm X was killed or Robert Kennedy, it felt to many as if an era had passed, and there was confusion about the direction of the people and the future of the movement. There have been moments throughout history where people have been like sheep without a shepherd. Usually, the assassinations of people are purposely carried out in order to create those moments of desperation and confusion, because in those moments, anyone can fill that vacuum or so it is believed. Murderous trauma, think about it. Murderous trauma brought Lyndon Johnson into office, and Vietnam ran him out. In that vacuum, Richard Nixon was elected, and lying and law-breaking brought in Gerald Ford as an elevated former vice president who made a deal to pardon the disgraced Nixon. Trauma and deal-making and deceit brought about a peanut farmer and a devout Baptist, and possibly too devout to be an effective politician. Then there was Reagan after the demoralizing impotence of hostages being held in Iran. Then there was the fateful Vice President George H.W. Bush, who served a term but due to concerns and questions over the Gulf War and the rising strength and focus of white evangelicals and their distrust of a good Episcopalian, George H.W. Bush, he lost the next election. Then came the good old boy, Bill Clinton, who felt in order to get elected, he needed to pull the Democratic Party further to the right. He did that and was elected two terms. But financial and sex scandals brought his presidency under question, and the white evangelicals were seen praying in front of the White House on a daily basis, particularly after the Monica Lewinsky revelation. Then there was a Texas talking, walking George W. Bush, and September 11th defined his presidency, and he held on to office with the support of the white evangelicals, entanglement in wars, and the country's fear of terrorism. And that opens the chapter to Barack Obama, who was elected in a new coalition of blacks and whites and Latinos, the old and the young turning out. And he served without scandal, but also without support from the U.S. Congress. Many throughout the black and in other communities were so proud of this great historical accomplishment that we failed to press for far-reaching progressive agendas. And America used the election of a black man to declare that its problems with race and racism were now a thing of the past. People speculated that we were in a new and post-racial era, and the protest movements that had been dotted throughout history were now a thing of the past. 8 years, however, Barack Obama caused a reaction from the white religious right, white supremacists, and other racial hate groups who desperately felt that America had gone, had disappeared, had left them after 8 years of Obama, and they cried out that they needed to get America back. Along comes a con artist, riding the wave of racial backlash and fear over black and brown demonic hordes seeking to take over the country and to fill into every space that once was the United States of America. Here they were, filled with fear that somehow they were being taken over by people who were not solely white, but people who came from every single continent and every single country on the globe, people who spoke funny languages and looked very different. And they said, oh my God, we've lost the country and we got to figure out a way to get it back. And your con artist came along and massaged it and played games with it, is still playing games with it. And people really think that some things are happening for the positive when in fact the country has gone from bad to worse. The country is headed downhill on a bobsled, and somebody needs to stand up and morally reclaim the country from the quagmire and the destruction we find ourselves in. What I'm getting at is that they were folk without a shepherd. They were out there feeling desperate. Nobody had taught them that the world was not predominantly white.
All right.
Nobody had taught them that there were people who spoke different languages and even had different religions and came from different continents. Nobody taught them that just because somebody is different, it doesn't mean that they are a threat to you.
Yeah. Yeah.
Somebody didn't teach them that everybody wants the same thing. Health and security, and to be able to raise up their families, to feel that their children are protected and their children have a greater opportunity than was afforded them in a previous generation. Somebody didn't teach them. Somebody said, poverty in this country is equated with black folk. And people bought into the racialization of poverty, when in fact there are more poor whites in this country than black folks.
That's right.
But the issue is that folks came and massaged all kinds of misinformation. And there were people who were desperately looking for a shepherd, and a con artist stepped in and said, I'm going to lead you where you think you want to go. I'm going to lead you where you think you need to go. And oh, by the way, I'm going to steal everything along the way while I'm leading you. I'm going to pick your pockets clean, and you're not even going to know that your pockets have been picked clean. People are always looking for a shepherd, a leader. Many of the shepherds are so-called shepherds, like this current so-called shepherd of this nation, have exploited racial fears and hatred. We are always looking for a shepherd, someone to guide us through the wilderness of life and the fears we face in life. And so Jesus says in the 10th chapter of John, verse 9, he says, I am the gate. Whoever enters by me will be saved and will come in and go out and find pasture. The thief only comes to steal and kill and destroy. I came that they may have life and have it abundantly. I am the good shepherd. The good shepherd lays down his life for the sheep. You see, the good shepherd is there to the end. The good shepherd. The good shepherd puts the care of others first. Just think about Jesus' definition of the good shepherd. When they came and they said, look, you need to leave here because Herod wants to kill you. And he says, you go and tell that fox that I'm here today and I'm here tomorrow and the day after that I'm going to move on, because it does a prophet no good to die outside of Jerusalem. In other words, he wasn't backing down or running away just because somebody was trying to instill some fear in him, to threaten and tell him that somebody's about to take your life if you continue to do this. For many of us, we would retreat. We would stop doing what we were doing. If somebody comes and says, Cooper, I'm going to lock you up for that. Right. Cooper says, no, you ain't going to lock me up because I ain't going to do that no more. That's our natural inclination. But Jesus is saying the good shepherd stands on that which was right. The good shepherd cares for the people. The good shepherd tries to build up rather than tear down. The good shepherd tries to offer vehicles of salvation and hope. The good shepherd tries to bring light into the midst of the darkness. The good shepherd tells you and reminds you that you are a child of God. A good shepherd is the one that brings redemption and hope and power. Jesus is talking about when he looked at the people. He was moved with compassion. He knew the people needed something and someone who would not lead them astray. Now I want you to hear this. The people have been waiting and looking and hoping. The people have been feeling desperate for a long time. The people have been in search of someone or something. And when you read through the text, you know, they thought that someone might have been John the Baptist, but Herod killed him. Some people thought that the answer might be Barabbas, but he faded into history. Some people lodged their hopes in the Zealot movement, and that movement was hunted and haunted by the Romans. And then there came Jesus, embodying the hopes of John the Baptist, and the hopes and the spirit of Barabbas, and the intoning of the zealots. He was also a healer and a teacher and someone that challenged the status quo that ended up being built upon oppression and putting people down. Jesus came and began to dismantle that stone by stone, concept by concept, ideology by ideology. Jesus came lifting people up and teaching them and showing them the way. And because he was moved with compassion. And they saw the sincerity and the love in him coming from him, they came running. They came running from the east. And they came running from the west. They came running from the lowlands, and they came running from the high grounds. They came because someone they heard along the way got healed. They came because someone found some insight for their living and for their life. They came because all that came told it to somebody, that they had been to someone who was sincere and cared and changed lives and tried to change the world because he believed in a loving and living God.
Yeah. Yeah.
Somebody told a story somewhere. Somebody said, this is how I got over today. Somebody said, this is why I'm still able to be standing in the land of the living today.
Yeah.
Somebody said that I went and all the hope had been drained out of me and I heard him teaching and all of a sudden I began to understand that I had to go through this thing in order to get to the next phase in my life. Somebody told him. Somebody said, you know, he touched me and the pain was taken away. He touched me and my body was healed. I didn't even get to touch him, but I touched the hem of his garment and all of a sudden my life was made right. You see, but part of that is that we bring our expectation to the context. Expectation. Somebody heard that somebody had gotten healed, and somebody said, well, maybe that will include me if I can only get there. So you're bringing some expectation to the moment. You're not going there if you believe that it's just a tall tale. You're not going there if you believe that it's a lie that somebody made up. But you're going out of your desperation that meets your hope, and therefore you go and you stand into the presence of God, and what people ended up tracking down Jesus, and they basically said, let me be changed and lifted up and altered this day for the good.
Yeah.
Many came looking, and many found. Many came looking for what was missing in their lives. And many found what they were looking for. Many came looking for grounding in a shaky world, and they found it. Many came looking for salvation and life and healing and hope, and they found the shepherd who cared for them. Many came because they wanted a compassionate and caring God that cared for them even when they were poor. Cared for them even when they felt desperate, cared for them even when they were alone. They came to Jesus because he said, just as you are, just as you are, come. Just as you are. Now, I'm going to sit down in a moment, I promise. But sometimes I don't think we fully understand the world that Jesus was operating in. Jesus was operating in a world that was stratified. You had those on the top, you had those here, you had those here, and you had those who are very much on the bottom that everybody felt was no good and unclean, and there was nothing of worth there. Now the problem is that the majority of the population was on the bottom. Because you didn't want to stay there, right? But the majority was on the bottom. Didn't own land, were basically subsistent farmers, if they were subsistent farmers, were subsistent herders, if that's what they were. But most folk were on the bottom and did not have a thing. And you know that in order to get into the temple, you had to have money to be able to buy a sacrifice.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
In order to get into the temple, your body could not be injured and you could not be mutilated in any way. Just think of the scripture. And what happens when you're on the bottom and you work in the fields every day or you work into some kind of menial labor is that you end up having a deformed body many, many times because of accidents that happen in your profession.
Yes.
So here they were, believing in God but without God. Here they were, a people that basically everybody else had given up on. Here they were, alone and feeling desperate and feeling frustrated. And then all of a sudden, a teacher comes along and says, I'm going to touch you because I believe in you. I'm going to touch you because I love you. I'm going to touch you because you are a child of God that the whole world may have forgotten about you. But as a vehicle of God, I'm here to touch you and to tell you that you are of worth to God. We need that word today. We need that word today when the whole world tries to tell us that we're of no account, when the whole world tries to tell us that we're just simply criminals, when the whole world tries to tell us that we're poor folk and poor folk don't count, when the whole world tries to tell us that our skin is the wrong color, when the whole world tries to tell us that our religion is the wrong thing. Somebody needs to remind us that we are children of God and therefore created by God and called into purpose because of God. Now, if you can understand that context and why I would get up and leave my village and go find this itinerant preacher. If you can imagine why I would get up and go and seek him out. If you can imagine that I would get up from whatever comfort I have and go out to find him in an out of the way place because my body needed to be healed. My mind needed to be made right. My life needed to be straightened out. And because he did not reject me, but he loves me and has called me into his presence just as we are. To come in to his midst. That's why Jesus says, I am the good shepherd, y'all. Because I will take it all the way to the end. And he took it all the way to the end. Because they came and they said, give up your shepherding. And he says, well, no, I'm just going to walk on to Jerusalem. Give up your shepherding. No, I'm going to continue to preach on today and tomorrow. Give up your shepherding. Oh, they're going to put me on trial. I'm not going to say a mumbling word before the powers that think they have power because I know who got power and you don't have power, but God has power. And so he stood before the powers of the world. Didn't give up his shepherding. Went to a cross because he was the good shepherd. Went to the cross and they pierced him in the side on that cross. He was still the good shepherd. They laid him in a tomb. He was still a good shepherd. And when he got up bright and early on that morning, it was the good shepherd that was getting up and opening up all creation, heaven and creation to the people who followed him. The good shepherd. Y'all know what I'm talking about when I say the good shepherd? The good shepherd. The good shepherd. You know, I keep telling the story, and I tell it over and over again, but the peace that came over me sitting down at Central Cell Block in a place that was filled with roaches was only because of the good shepherd that was speaking to me in the midst of distress. Because that wasn't me, Bernstein. You know, I get agitated. But there was a peace. And all of a sudden, I understood that scripture, right? That peace that passes all understanding, because I'm still trying to figure it out.
Yeah.
I'm still trying to understand it. But then I knew that I was not alone. Then I knew I was coming through that. Then I knew that God had reached in beyond the bars and touched me, that the Holy Spirit was there with me. Then I knew that I was being shepherded by the good shepherd, and that when dawn would come and the sun would come up, then the power of God would come up in me, because God had ordained it to die with him is to be able to rise with Christ.
Yes.
The good shepherd. So many got up and came because they saw something and heard something. on this note, he's still doing it right now. Still changing lives right now. Still healing bodies right now. Still taking us from mess to bless right now. Still taking a situation and turning it around.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Still taking us when we're upside down and giving us the direction to make it right side up. Taking us in our brokenness and giving, he's still doing it. He's still doing it. Does somebody here, has he done something for you lately? Has he touched you lately? Has he blessed you lately? Have he healed you lately? Doors of the church are open. If somebody here today knows what he's done and that you need some more, I'm going to invite you forward. If you want to unite in fellowship with Plymouth Church, I'm going to invite you forward. The doors of the church are open, and I invite you to come and be a part of this community of faith. If you have not yet made that commitment, and you need to make that commitment to Jesus to ask that you be filled with new power, then come forth during the singing of this hymn. Reverend Harmon, amen. Praise God. Amen. 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 Praise the Lord. And Reverend Harmon has made a transfer of membership from the church where he was down in Richmond, Virginia. And so it's good to have him here. He's also really back home because he was raised in Tacoma Park. Amen. Amen. And so we really rejoice and give thanks to God and for his son that comes and blesses him constantly and brings him to church. And you're joining too.
Yes.
Amen. And he's joining as well.
Amen.
Amen. And
that's his great granddaughter.
This is a great granddaughter. Praise God. Amen. Yes. Beautiful great granddaughter. Amen. How you doing?
Yeah.
Wanna come up? Want me to pick you up? Oh. Amen. She's very, very happy. And we rejoice in that. And let us, as we prepare to pray together, I'm going to invite, Deacon Taylor, I don't want to put more on you, but I am. And I'm going to ask Deacon Taylor and Brother Cooper if you could join and be prayer partners together right here today, all right?
Amen.
Amen. And we rejoice and give thanks. And let us pray together. Lord, we thank you in this time, this day, this moment, to be blessed in this way, Lord. To be blessed with Reverend Harmon and blessed with his son, Lord. We just thank you for all of the wonder and miracles that you continue to provide and all the things that you have allowed us to see and experience. And we thank you for this man of God being in the midst of the people of God. Bless us now as we endeavor forth. We pray this prayer. In Jesus' name, amen. Okay, what, down now? Hey, right. Amen. Thank you. Amen. And the diaconate actually is going to be in touch with you and give you some instructions on the next steps.
Okay.
All right. Bless you. Amen. You got anything you want to say? You want to say something?
I love everyone. Aww.
She loves everyone. Beautiful thing. That's so beautiful. Amen. Amen. We give thanks to God for the blessings of this day. Amen. And as we prepare to adjourn from our worship today, I'm going to invite you to stand and prepare to join in the song number 489. Victory is mine. And as we prepare to adjourn from our worship this day, I'm going to ask if Minister Lewis, if you can come forth and lift up our benediction.
what is Jesus there all this way?
She when is her birthday? August the what? That's okay, because I'm born in August. August 7th. It's a great month.
That's right.
Yeah.